just a personal word to begin with. The move that we made was, in reflecting back on it, it was the right time and the right thing for us to do. That not to say that it was without some costs for us in terms of things that we cherish, and that we enjoyed our home and enjoyed sharing it with all of you. But the years have gone by and they've taken their toll, and it's time for us to live, as it were, at Las Palmas from meal to meal. Somehow our lives are determined by the fact that we must be in the dining hall at 8 in the morning if we want to eat breakfast, and at 12:30 if we want to eat our main meal of the day, and back again at dinner time. And then we can fit in what we wish amid all of that. But it is good. The major observation I'd have to say in terms of the relationships there, we really do miss seeing the faces of some younger people. Our community ranges in age basically from probably the late 60s up to over 100. As a matter of fact, one gentleman, well, and his wife, who share meals with us occasionally, he's a former race car driver. He's 100 years old, and he's still driving. Got a new car for his 100th birthday. Unfortunately, they live in the cottage furthest from the dining hall, so they have to drive down and drive back, and that's not great in inclement weather. But they've asked for an apartment in that big building, and hopefully that'll happen. So there are ups and downs of that, but we're adjusting, and glad to be back, glad to be exploring some new horizons. Today is Reformation Sunday. In case you didn't gather that, I don't often wear anything here of liturgical significance, but that's why I have the red stole today. Traditional in Protestant, but not Catholic, churches, for obvious reasons. I hope you had a chance to take a at the UU World. All of you should be getting it, and if you're really new members here, it'll take a while to get on the list. There are some outstanding things in UU World, and I'll tell you a secret. There's not much that I have to say this morning that really is original. I borrowed my thoughts from Peter Morales, who's our UU president, and I think that he had some important insights for us. So, who are we? Who are Unitarian Universalists? In a multi-faith religious community, we often claim our place as the liberal church. And it feels like that in a community where the dominant religious groups are rigid or heavy on doctrine. However, if we claim our place as the liberal church, we're ignoring countless allies. In the late 1400s, Martin Luther had started studies to be a lawyer, but a personal religious experience turned him toward the priesthood. And of course, no options at that point in the Roman Church. But the monastery in which he went, he was discouraged because of the immorality and the corruption that he found there among his fellow priests. So this led him to a change of course and to taking some studies at the University of Wittenberg, where he excelled in attaining the degree of doctor of theology, interestingly enough, and he became their professor of theology at the University of Wittenberg. He was deeply troubled by the many doctrines and practices of the Roman Church, and it all came to a head for him when Pope Leo announced a new plan to sell indulgences to help pay for the St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. So, what's an indulgence? We separated brethren are not aware of some of these things. The idea of indulgences arose when it was observed that many people have been so very good, it was believed that others could access these excess good deeds for personal benefit with a small monetary offering. You see, if you are really good and have a surplus credit with the divine bookkeeper, maybe I can buy some of your credits for a modest offering and get free of some of those burdens that I've been carrying, the guilt of things that I should have done, that I didn't do. That is an indulgence. One person receiving a transfer of merit from a saintly person, for instance, a Mother Teresa, who was so giving in her own life in caring especially for the poor in India. And that practice has long been abused. And many in the Roman Church wondered then, and I suspect wonder even now, why the practice was not condemned long ago. Now, I'm not sure I have my dates right on this. It's the day before Reformation Day, and I thought I read my calendar right, but maybe somebody has pricked my thinking on this. It may be 499 years since the initiating event here, but whichever way, very possibly, tomorrow is the 500th anniversary of of the beginning of the Reformation, when Luther, wanting to initiate a discussion among fellow clergy and learned people, nailed his list of concerns. We need to talk about it. He nailed that to the chapel door at Wittenberg. This was the way of communicating with other people. Although it came at a time when it wasn't that simple. So he was asking for a discussion of these things, an honest and sincere discussion about the questions that he had raised, including questions concerning indulgences. But that's not the way it went. It was taken as an attack on the practices and authority of the Roman Church. So Luther's life was changed forever on that day, and the future and shape of the Christian movement was forever changed. So this was the common way of communicating, nailing those theses, as it were, on the chapel door at the University of Wittenberg. But there was a printing press now, and that list of theses that Luther nailed up there became widely circulated, unlike anything earlier. Thus, Luther was no longer an ordinary parish priest. He quickly became the center of controversy. The question, the authority and the practices of the Roman-dominated Christianity. When Luther raised the question of indulgences, it was and became a very hot topic. One year after nailing those questions to the chapel door, Luther was called before a cardinal in Augsburg. And he was ordered to recant his 95 points of discussion, ordered by the Pope. And Luther agreed. He agreed if he could be proved wrong by Scripture. He further objected to the idea that the Pope had authority to interpret sacred writings. So that meeting set in motion a process of separating Luther from the church of his roots. And in January of 1521, it was official. Luther was out, excommunicated. And later that same year, his writings were banned, and he was declared a convicted heretic. And that made him a condemned and wanted man, making it necessary for him to hide. Well, while hiding, Luther translated the New Testament into his native German so that common folk could read it and draw their own conclusions. few years later, still in hiding, Luther married a former nun, Katharina von Bora, and they subsequently gave birth to 6 children. One thing I regret hearing in the story about Luther at this point was his writing about his bias against Jews and Muslims. If he had only stuck to the authority of the Pope, I for one would have been much happier, particularly in terms of the emphasis now that our own Peter Morales is suggesting to us. It's amazing that Luther remained safe until his death on February 18, 1546. At that point, he was 62 years old. We need to remember that many of the reformers who followed paid with their lives for their religious freedom and, in a real sense, for our religious freedom. The climate had been tense anyway, and the hatred of the Roman hierarchy for the Reformed movement as early as 1428 was so intense that church authorities had the body of John Wycliffe removed from his grave and burned as belated punishment for translating the Bible into English. What a crime. Though this happened 100 years before Luther's 95 Theses, it was a movement in process and growing. It was part of the climate when Luther raised his issues for discussion. So with the Reformation came a splintering of Christianity that paved the way for liberal expressions of really every religious group today. The resulting divisions became the platform for the free and open exploration of religious ideas and spiritual practices. Without that Reformation, there would have been no room for liberal religious thinking, at least as the record would suggest. So the Protestant Reformation opened the way for not only liberal religion, but for a multi-faith movement, of which Peter Morales wrote in the UU World. And he called it, "The future of liberal religion is multi-faith." Now, in the face of that, it may not connect for us, but to hear Peter's words, when we think of religious differences that divide people, we usually think of major religious traditions: Christians, Jews, Muslims, Hindus, Buddhists, what have you. He says, however, that major religious divisions today are no longer between faiths, but rather along the spectrum from reactionary to progressive. For example, it has been long obvious that progressive Jews and Christians and Muslims have more in common with one another and with Unitarian Universalists than they do with most reactionary members of their own faith. And I can say that from my own experience, loud and long, the experience of the extreme within even the United Church of Christ, but within Protestantism, has been a concern, a deep concern. And so I've lost my place. I'm wondering too much.
That makes us all feel better.
Pardon?
That makes us all feel better.
Oh, good. Good, good.
We wandered.
He goes on to say that he notes that UUs have much more in common with the United Church of Christ than most members of the United Church of Christ have with fundamentalist Christians. This is borne out in our shared attitudes toward science, acceptance of sexual diversity, marriage equality, and the openness of people of other to other people of other faith traditions like Judaism and Islam. He comments about the times then, and I can imagine him as the leader of a major, well, maybe not so major, but a significant denomination, people within our nation. I can imagine him as he stood with the liberals of other faith groups, with Jews, with Muslims, standing with them in witness for voting rights, environmental justice, immigration reform, and marriage equality. And he states that he had joined with liberals of other faith traditions, marching together and going to jail together. He insists that the future of liberal religion is inherently, therefore, multi-faith. Many of the more traditional people in those religious organization would not show up in that kind of situation, but the more liberal-minded and open-minded among them have and do. I was interested in a further comment in a subsequent article here on the reflections of the pastor of a friend of mine, a woman who holds joint UU clergy standing and UCC standing. She's a pastor of a federated church in Sterling, Massachusetts. And she comments that one of the problems for us as UUs is that we are not clear about our identity. She says, when you know where your place is and who you are, it is much easier to form interfaith partnerships. As a liberal faith group, we have allies among liberal Jews and Muslims and others. If we can negotiate and honor our differences, we can stand together on crucial issues. And it's another place where that late UU pastor, Forrest Church, provided a metaphor for our journey among religious liberals, and we have just sung a hymn that puts that into poetic language. And you've heard me comment about it before, that Forrest Church suggested that our religious communities are like windows in a great cathedral, where we each see the light of truth coming from outside through the beautiful but unique stained glass windows, and we each perceive it a bit differently, and ought to honor that. Each of us has a different experience of that light. If we accept the metaphor, as in the song that we sang, then we know our place among religious groups and can walk together in peace, giving witness to our common concerns. We have a lot to gain as we ally ourselves with other religious liberals, uniting in common concerns while allowing each other the freedom to express our faith within the integrity of our unique communities. So, 95 Theses on the Wittenberg Chapel Door created a revolution and sparked the freedom of religious expression, which we now hold dear.